So today's daf is daf kuftet in Pesachim. We're going to dedicate today's shiur in memory of Chacham Ovadia Yosef, zichrono livracha. We are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines from the top of the Amud Tanya. It says in the Braita, Amru alav al Rabbi Akiva. Oh, you don't have the book. They said about Rabbi Akiva that Miyamav lo amar higia et laamod bebet midrash. He never said it's time to go home from the Beit Midrash. Unless, chutz me'arvei Pesachim ve'erev Yom Kippurim. So the only time he would ever say it's time to go home was Erev Pesach and Erev Yom Kippur. Why? Ve'erev Pesach bishvil tinokot kedei shelo yishnu. That on Erev Pesach, he told everyone to go home because he wanted the children not to sleep on the night of Pesach. So what does this mean? So the Rashbam gives a couple of interpretations of what this means. Either he sent everybody home from the Beit Midrash so they would put their kids to take a nap. And that way they wouldn't sleep during the Seder because they took a nap during the day. Or it could mean that he wanted people to get home in time to start the Seder early as possible so that the children would still be awake. But either way, he would end the Shi'ur in the Beit Midrash in a timely fashion, only on Erev Pesach and Erev Yom Kippur, because he wanted people to get home for some mitzvah. Either it was Erev Pesach or Erev Yom Kippur, HaKippurim. What was the reason for that? Kedei Shi'achilu Ad Benehem. Okay, so that they would feed their children. What does that mean? So the Rashbam again comes in and explains what they're not going to teach. They're not going to feed their children if they don't get home in time. What does that mean? So actually, does the Rashbam say it explicitly? Maybe he doesn't say it. Well, seemingly what this means is that if they didn't come home early enough, they would eat themselves, but they wouldn't feed the younger members of their family because they'd be so focused on having to rush to eat before the fast. So to make sure that everybody had a chance to eat, he would send them home early on Erev Pesach. A person is obligated to bring joy to his children and the members of his household on the holiday. Because it says, you should rejoice in your holiday. And we know the pasuk goes on to say, you, your son, your daughter, your servant, etc. Everybody has to be involved. So the question is, what does that mean? What do you do to make them happy? With wine. Wine is the source of rejoicing.
And you have to give wine to your kids.
Apparently so. Rabbi of grape juice. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Anashim Barot Oilehem, V'Nashim Barot Oilehem. Men get what's appropriate for them. Women get what's appropriate for them. Anashim Barot Oilehem B'Yayin. Men like to drink wine. V'Nashim B'Mai. So what should the women have? Tani Rav Yosef, B'Bavel, B'Begdei Tzivonim. Be'Eretz Yisrael, B'Begdei Pishtan Megoatzim. That in Israel, in Bavel, they would give them colored clothing. In other words, nice, colorful clothing. That was the style. In Israel, they would give them these fine linen pressed garments. Apparently that was the style. But the point was, whatever the nice garments were, that they would feel that they had a new dress to wear for the holiday, that brought them a lot of simcha. We know that that's true, certainly. Tani Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera Omer. Rabbi Yehuda ben Betera said, "Bezman shebet haMikdash kayam en simcha el b'basar, shenemar v'zavachta shelamim v'achalta sham, v'samachta lefnei Hashem Elohecha." That in the times of the Beit HaMikdash, the only way you could have real simcha was with meat. As it says, you should slaughter these shelamim offerings, and you should eat them there. V'samachta lefnei Hashem Elohecha, and you should celebrate. In other words, the eating of meat was a part of the celebration. V'achshav shein Beit HaMikdash kayam, now that we don't have the Beit HaMikdash anymore, en simcha el b'yayin. We only have wine.
So that the simcha of the meat is not in the eating; it is the eating the
korban.
The korban,
right? Ela b'yayin, right? Shene emar b'yayin yisamach levavenosh. Right now, there's a big question here. Because according to the Shulchan Aruch, so the Shulchan Aruch, many Rishonim take this to mean that we don't need to eat meat on Yom Tov anymore. Right. Because look, it is now it's in simcha b'yayin. So that's what the Shulchan Aruch says. The Shulchan Aruch actually doesn't mention eating meat. However, many poskim bring it because the Rambam brings it. The Rambam brings it. You have to eat meat on Yom Tov.
Right.
Right? So the Beit Yosef, though, says, no. Look, at the Gemara says, Ein simcha el b'yayin. Nowadays, we don't have the Beit HaMikdash, it's yayin. And many Rishonim bring that same question. So therefore, the Shulchan Aruch itself actually just mentions wine, doesn't mention meat. But if you look at, for example, Chacham Avadia and Yalkut Yosef, he says the person should eat meat. Now, so everybody asks the question, how does the Rambam learn this Gemara that seems to explicitly say that there is no obligation of meat nowadays? It was only in the Beit HaMikdash times. So one possible way of explaining it, I'm not saying this as an absolute definitely the answer, but one possible approach is that it's not exclusionary, but it's adding something. In other words, it's saying in the time of the Beit HaMikdash, all you needed was the basar, because you had the Beit HaMikdash to give you that inspired feeling. So eating the meat already gave you an inspired feeling. Nowadays, that we don't have the Beit HaMikdash, we need also yayin. In other words, it's not enough to have the meat alone. You need also wine, because you don't have, because it used to be that you would go to the Beit HaMikdash with your meat, so it was a powerful experience. Now what's going to give you that powerful experience? Just you're eating a steak? Eating a steak you do all the time. So you need the yayin to give it a different quality to the eating. That's one possible way. I'm just suggesting that as a possible way that I thought of answering the Rambam.
The Shulchan Aruch takes this,
as a source, that you only need wine. Mm-hmm. Because the literal reading is like that. So now, Amar Rabbi Yitzchak says, "Kista demorisa dahava b'tzipori." There was a certain type of measuring cup that they would use to sell brine. It was like a measuring cup that they would sell brine by a certain volume that they had in tzipori. He havat kimin loga demikdasha. This was the same amount as the log measurement of the Beit HaMikdash. So therefore, ubami sharin rivi'it shel Pesach. And so what they would do was they would take it, they would fill this container that they knew was the same as the log of the Beit HaMikdash, and they would pour it into four cups, and they knew that each one was a revi'it, because what is a revi'it? It's a fourth of a log. This is a log, then whatever I divide it into four, and I have four.
We call a cheekful.
A cheekful is even less. Revi'it is the amount you have to start with. Cheekful is what you have to drink.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
So, Amar Rabbi Yochanan says, Timnaita kademaita tahava betaveria. There was a certain measurement called a tamnita or a timniata or a whatever it is, or tamniata, whatever it is, tahava betaveria, that they used to have an old one. Havat yetera al da riva. He said that there was an old kind of a measuring cup called a tamnita or whatever it is, that or tamnyata, and then there was a new version of it, and the difference between the current version and the old version was a rivi'it. So what could they do? They would fill up the current version, okay, or they would fill up the old version rather, which was larger by a rivi'it, and they would pour it into the new version, and whatever was left in the old version, the old measuring cup, they knew that it was a revi'it, because they knew it was a revi'it more. So that's how they could measure revi'it. Rav Chisda says, revi'it shel Torah etzbaim al etzbaim, birum etzbaim. So he says that if you want to know a revi'it by volume, you have a container that's two fingers width by two fingers width. Okay, that's the measurement. And then the height of it is two etzba and a half and a fifth. Okay? So that's the measurements. Because they didn't do fraction, they don't combine the fraction together. Okay, but the point is, I guess what would that be in a that would be a half and a fifth. So you'd have to make the common denominator is 10. So you'd put a fifth, it would be 2/10. And for a half it would be 5/10, right? So it would be 7/10, okay? So you see, I can still do fractions, and I haven't been in school for a long time.
It's like TUS, but it's an even more complicated algorithm.
Yeah. Because he's going into a whole complicated way of calculating it, yes. We're not going to go into that, but and he has even some, on the side, he has a whole drawing there. But the point is that this is how you could measure it by volume. So you would have the 2 etzba by 2 etzba, and the height of 7 of 2 7/10 etzba, and then if you fill the container of those dimensions with the liquid, that would be a revi'it.
Okay.
As we learned in a braita, when we talk about going into the mikveh, what do we say? It says you should wash in water all of his flesh. That nothing should be interposing between his flesh and the water. So and then it says when it says b'mayim, it doesn't say b'mayim in any water, but b'mayim. In the water, b'mei mikveh, which means it has to be water that qualifies as a mikveh. Et kol b'saro, what does it mean, all of his flesh? Mayim shekol gufo ole b'hen. It has to be water that his entire body can fit in at once. In other words, he can't put in one arm, then another arm, then his leg. He has to go in all at once to do tevilah. V'chamahen, and how do we measure this? Ama al ama berom shalosh amot. If you have one ama by one ama, at the height of three amot. So in other words, if you made a mikveh that was one ama by one ama in its length and width, and then you had three amot high and you filled it, that would be a mikveh that a person could go into and would be able to, because if you figure three amot is, if an ama is a foot and a half, right? So you're talking about it's a foot and a half by a foot and a half. And the height is 4.5 feet. Right, anybody could dunk in that pretty much if they dunk it. V'shi'aru chachamim shi'ur me'mikveh arba'im sa'ah. And of course, the rabbis measured this as arba'im sa'ah. They said that the quantity of water is 40 sa'ah. So if you do the math, in other words, you have to look at the long Rashi where he does this, because the way that they did their fractions was they did it all by area, by dividing up area, right? So it's really like very complicated, and that's the way that Rashi does all his calculations. But basically, if you do the math, you'll find that etzba, what we said before, two etzba by two etzba at a height of 2 7/10 etzba is going, that is the amount of a revi'it. If you figure out the proportion, then an ama by an ama at the height of three amot will fit into it, will in other words be proportional. They're proving it from here. From the fact that three amot height and one by one ama length and width of the mikveh is 40 sa'ah, you can, if you take the fraction of 40 sa'ah that is a revi'it, and the fraction of that length and width and height that is 2 etzba'im by 2 etzba'im at the height of 2 7/10 etzba, then you'll find that it's exactly proportional, which is a proof to this ratio of volume to length, width, and height. That's the long Rashi there. Now, Amar Rav Ashi says, Amar li Ravin Bar Hanina said to me, Shulchan shel mikdash shel perikim hava. The shulchan in the Kodesh at the Beit HaMikdash must have been made from pieces. In other words, you could take it apart. How do we know you could take it apart? Because the Isal gadat achaduke hava mihadak. Because if you're going to tell me that it was actually one piece and it couldn't be broken into pieces, then how could they put it into the mikveh, which was only one amah by one amah? The mikveh that they had was one amah by one amah in the Beit HaMikdash. So how are they going to fit a one amah table? How are they going to fit a table that's as large as the shulchan?
They put
right?
The furniture in the mikveh.
If it became tamei, how are they ever going to be able to fit it in?
That's how they...
They did, yeah. Sometimes they had to put the furniture into the mikveh. So if they did, so how would they be able to fit it in to a one amah mikveh by one amah? It's not going to fit. So they must have had to take it apart and put each piece in. So my kushya, what's the problem? Dilma biyam shasa Shlomo havamat bilei. Maybe they just put it into the mikveh that Shlomo made. When Shlomo HaMelech made the Beit HaMikdash, he made something called the Yam Shel Shlomo, which was a huge mikveh basically in the front that had, you know, that held many mikvahot. Detani Rabbi Chiyas said Yam shasa Shlomo machzik me'av ha'mishim mikveh taura. That if you were to, you could put 150 mikvahot into the Yam Shel Shlomo. So definitely, if they had a large piece of equipment, so to speak, a large piece of furniture that they needed to dip, they would be able to dip it into the Yam Shel Shlomo, even though it wouldn't fit into an ordinary mikveh. So there's your proof that, or there's that deflects your proof that the Shulchan of the Beit HaMikdash must have been made of pieces. It wasn't necessarily made of pieces. It could be that it wasn't, that it was all one piece, but you could fit.
Because this just talks about the minimum, but it doesn't say that it has to be.
Right, well, so the Mefarshim say, the Mefarshim point that out. They say it must be that that was the size of the mikveh that they had in the Beit HaMikdash, because otherwise what are they asking the question? Why can't they just have a larger one? So it must be that they had a mikveh in the Beit HaMikdash which was of the minimal measurements. And so they were asking, how could they fit the Shulchan into that? There must be.
Yeah.
So the Mefarshim say. So we have four kosot on Pesach. Now, in order to understand this, you have to understand that they had a concept of zugot. Zugot was basically some kind of a superstitious thing that if things are an even number, something bad can happen to you. Okay, that was the belief. Now the Meiri and many of the Mefarshim say that the Chachamim didn't really think that Zugot were dangerous. It was really a folk superstition. That's what the Meiri says. But he says that the Chachamim always tried to explain things in a way that people could understand. So they didn't want to go out to the people and be like, no, stop with the Zugot because people won't be able to accept it. So instead they tried to explain around it. They tried to work around it because they thought that these types of superstitions weren't the worst thing. They weren't related to idolatry. But they didn't want to shake the boat too much. You know, you rock the boat too much, the people won't be able to handle it. So how could they institute four cups if it's an even number? It says in the Braita, a person shouldn't eat two, in other words, two portions of something, because that is zugot. Velo yishtetre, he shouldn't drink two cups. Velo yikaneh tre, and he shouldn't wipe two. In other words, he shouldn't dry his hand, it would seem, that means twice. Okay? And a person should not Velo yaset tzrachav tre, he shouldn't have marital relations twice. Right? You shouldn't have marital relations twice. So any of these things, doing it twice is bad. So to hear, how can we have four cups? Four cups is obviously an even number, and therefore is a problem of zugot. So what's the answer? So the Chachamim give several answers here. Amar Rav Nachman, Amar Kra Leil Shimurim, Leil Shumaruba, Min Amazikin. Rav Nachman says, it's called Leil Shimurim. Pesach is the night of being guarded. Don't worry. So even though you're doing something risky,
right,
it's okay.
Right.
You're going to be all right. That's why some people say hamapil on Pesach.
Right.
Right when you go to sleep, kriyat shema shel amita, because you don't need shmirah. Rava Amar, Rava says, kos shel bracha mitzref l'tova v'eno mitzref l'ra'a. The kos shel bracha, the cup of birkat hamazon, is only counted for good, not for bad. So really, you only have three cups. Really, you only have the first cup, and the second cup, and the last cup. But the third cup of Birkat HaMazon, it only counts for good. It doesn't count for bad. So it's not going to cause you any harm. It doesn't count as Zugot. In other words, really, it's only three kosot, because the fourth one is a separate category of its own. Ravina Amar Arba'a Kasei Takinu Rabbanan Der Cherut. The rabbis instituted four cups Der Cherut after the manner of Cherut, in order to show freedom. Kol chad v'chad mitzvah ba'ape nafshahu. Okay, that each person, that each cup rather, is a mitzvah in its own right. And as Rashi says and Rashbam say, in mitzterfin zelaze. In other words, they don't combine together. We don't look at it as four cups and you have zugot. That's the wrong way to look at it. Look at it like this: you have one cup for kiddush, you have one cup for magid, you have one cup for birkat hamazon, and you have one cup for halal. It's not four cups. In other words, you look at each one as a separate mitzvah, we don't have so many problems. Then we said there, lo yaset tzrachav tzrei, a person should not have relations twice. Okay? So the Gemara asks, amai, why? Nimlachu. They don't combine together. It's two additional, it's two activities. In other words, it's not one. It's not like you're drinking two cups. It's two different activities if you do that. So what is it trying to say? What it means is like this. Amar Abaye Hachi Kamar. That's what it means. Lo yochal trev yishtetre velo yaset rachav afilu pamachat dil machalish umitra. What he means is like this. If you have, when it's said in the Baraita, don't eat two, drink two, and have relations twice. That's not what it meant. What it meant was, don't eat and then drink. Don't eat two portions. Drink two portions and then have relations at all. Why not? Because when you have relations, you are out of the framework of Shmirah. Right? You're out of God's protection, so to speak, potentially. You're exposing yourself. You're making yourself vulnerable. And you just had Zugot. And since you just had something that was Zugot, you have to protect yourself. So you shouldn't go from doing something that has this symbolic, you know, even numbers that are potentially dangerous, and then expose yourself to the danger by having marital relations. Better that you should go learn Torah or something like that, to protect yourself from the danger, rather than get involved in marital relations, which might expose you even more. And tomorrow we will continue in the Gemara that talks even more about these ideas of Zugot.